Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Jake Tapper. We'll begin with the national lead today on The Lead. It was the charge that could have assured that 25-year-old Army private Bradley Manning would spend the rest of his life behind bars, but a military judge today found Manning not guilty of aiding the enemy in the largest leak of classified intelligence in U.S. history. Manning already pleaded guilty to 10 of the 22 total counts he faced, and he was convicted for most of the rest of them today, including 5 counts of espionage. The former intelligence analyst showed the world what one man with a thumb drive and a head full of ideas can do, for right or for wrong. He admitted swiping about 700,000 documents while serving in Iraq and giving them to WikiLeaks, the outlet run by Julian Assange, which threw them up online for the world to see. The prosecution claimed that Manning knew al-Qaeda could use that information, and they said some of the information turned up in Osama bin Laden's compound, hence the unsuccessful aiding the enemy charge. WikiLeaks reacted to the verdict today on its Twitter account, calling it, quote, dangerous national security extremism from the Obama administration and a very serious new precedent for supplying information to the press. Manning may not get an outright life sentence, but his guilty plea and conviction on the other counts could bring more than 130 years in prison. The Army will not keep us in suspense on that. Sentencing is expected to happen tomorrow. If Edward Snowden has learned the news about Bradley Manning, it was probably in Russian and probably on a TV in the Moscow airport where he's been stuck for more than a month now as he seeks asylum. Snowden, of course, is that other former intelligence worker who has leaked a treasure trove of U.S. intelligence secrets, in his case, to media outlets such as the Guardian newspaper and the Washington Post. Snowden told the Guardian that he admires Manning, but he sees himself as different from Manning because he evaluated each document before disclosing it. Right now, I want to welcome Edward Snowden's father, Lon Snowden, along with his attorney, Bruce Fine, to The Lead. Thanks so much for being here. I appreciate it, Lon. After the verdict today, Manning found not guilty of aiding the enemy, guilty of 20 other charges. Does that give you any more hope that your son could get a fair trial in the U.S.?
No, not that he could get a fair trial in the U.S., absolutely not. And there's certainly different circumstances. People want to compare both cases completely different.
How are they different?
Well, first and foremost, I think my son has exercised discretion in the information that he has shared. I know you mentioned that he admires Bradley Manning. I think what he certainly admires is he's an individual who took a stand, and most Americans aren't aware of, I think, the initial video that Bradley Manning released and
right,
what that
showed.
Showed
you a U.S. helicopter killing innocent bystanders.
Of the two Reuters reporters, right, and shooting the two children through the windshield of the vehicle. That's correct. So
I think what we can assess with regard to how members of Congress and the public have responded to the disclosures of the dragnet surveillance of the NSA on every American citizen, that in the case of Mr. Snowden, he's disclosed government wrongdoing in the minds of Americans and members of the Congress of the United States who may be on the verge of enacting remedial legislation. And
although a minority of the members of the House of Representatives, it was almost defeated last week, but it did not pass.
For a variety of procedural reasons, it may come back in a different form in September and pass. But we certainly know the majority of the American people now have voiced grave concerns about the scope of that program, and it seems somewhat odd to be prosecuting somebody for disclosing government wrongdoing. You have a First Amendment right to petition government for redress of grievances. The other difference, I think, with regard to the statement about fair trial, mm-hmm, there have been a half dozen or a dozen high-profile people in Congress, including John Kerry, Secretary of State, already convicting Mr. Snowden of treason. They've stated categorically he's guilty. There hasn't even been a trial, not a peep of a presumption of innocence. The President of the United States has derided him as some kind of a hacker. And if you're going to have a fair trial, you have to have an unpoisoned jury. And that is not the case right now.
Lon, if your son is watching right now, which he may be, CNN is an international organization, what's your message to him?
My message to him is to stay safe, stay secure. And I hope he does, in fact, find refuge in Russia until we are confident that he can receive a fair trial back on U.S. soil. And at this time, my message to him is that I am not confident at all. I have stated it last night. I have absolutely no faith in the Attorney General of the United States, Eric Holder. We've attempted to work with the Justice Department. We have attempted to work with the Justice Department and the people who are conducting this investigation, and I have lost faith and their interest in ensuring that he is given a fair trial. I think the focus is to bring him back in and prosecute him to the fullest. You know, the focus is not justice, it's to prosecute
him. Is this because of the comments of people like Secretary and Kerry or, and others?
Yes, that's why.
In addition to that, the Attorney General had written a letter to the Ministry of Justice of the Russian Federation. We was trying to outline all the protections that Mr. Snowden
right,
would enjoy
would
if he
not
returned.
Be, they would not seek the death penalty. He would not be tortured.
Yes, yeah. And it speaks volumes that a Justice Department official has to promise that he won't commit torture because otherwise there's suspicion that they'd get the Bradley Manning treatment. But moreover, if you read the letter, it's deficient in several very critical respects. It doesn't argue that Mr. Snowden would enjoy the right to confront adverse witnesses against him, maybe trying to get information that's secret. It doesn't say that he would enjoy the right to call favorable witnesses in his defense. It doesn't promise a venue which hasn't been poisoned because it's the venue where NSA employees work or where contractors work. So if it was attempting to try to provide a comfort level that there would be a fair trial, it was deficient. And lastly, it didn't even say that he would enjoy a presumption of innocence.
Lon, surely you understand the basic idea that your son broke the law and is going to be punished one way or another in the eyes of the United States justice system. You don't dispute that. You just don't.
No, I do. No. I need to interject here.
Okay. You've said that he broke the law. That's not at all clear.
You disagree with that.
It could be that there was constantly protected speech was there, but that's why we have trials. That's why there's a presumption of innocence. And if there's one message I think that we need to send to Mr. Edward Snowden, the American people, what he hoped to accomplish has been achieved. He has sparked the conversation that Mr. Obama said was urgent. That's now occurring in the Congress of the United States and on this program today. If it wasn't for his courage, there would be no second guessing of these dragnet surveillance programs.
I do want to get your view as a father, though. You don't accept the proposition that he did anything illegal.
At this point, what I would like to see is the justice system applied fairly. Let's go back 50 years, almost 50 years to the day when Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech, and he reminded us that the U.S. Constitution is a promissory note to the American people. And he reminded correctly the American people that the government at that time was defaulting on that promise. And the reason being is we had laws, Jim Crow laws, you know, that were recognized as they're legal. It's legal. But you know what? They were unconstitutional. And so did my son face a moral hazard in which he had to make a choice between doing something that was unconstitutional, spying on the American people, unethical? You know, I believe he's seen much more than what we're aware of. And did he face the moral hazard of having to continue to do that day in, day out for the big paycheck and knowing that our government was violating the constitutional rights of over 300 million Americans?
Let me just give you a last word here because we're going to have to take a break, but that is President Obama presumably watches CNN as well. What would you say to him if he's watching?
Stay true to your oath. Support and defend the Constitution of the United States to the best of your ability. That is the top line of your job description. You know, you've said that you can't have 100% privacy and 100% security without 100% without some inconvenience. You know, what I would say as an American citizen is I expect you to respect my constitutional rights 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's your job as the President of the United States.
All right, Edward Snowden, his father, Lon Snowden, thank you for being here. Bruce Fein, his attorney, we welcome you to come back again and talk more about these important issues.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.